This is Ham Radio Now, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. And this is episode 534, that FCC-ARRL luncheon meeting, condensed. I'm Gary Pierce, K4AAQ. Last January, there was that remarkable, perhaps unprecedented presentation by several prominent members of the FCC and the ARRL. It was before the regular monthly luncheon for the 2-1 repeater group, Ham Radio Club in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. Now, I don't know about your radio club, but none of the clubs that I've belonged to have had a half dozen people from the FCC come talk to us about ham radio. That was unusual. You're going to recognize some of the names, particularly Laura Smith, the special counsel for amateur radio enforcement, and her predecessor in that job, now retired, Riley Hollingsworth, K4ZDH. Everybody else introduces themselves right up front, so I'm not going to do that now. They talk about a wide variety of subjects. They answer some questions from the audience, and the whole thing ran almost 2 hours. And it was recorded and presented on YouTube, where it gathered almost 4,500 views, which is not really a lot for an event of this significance. That's even after Josh Nass promoted it on the Ham Radio Crash Course. When I watched it, I noticed that the participants and the audience sometimes got a little off track and kind of disjointed, particularly one FCC engineer who had some really interesting things to say, but kind of got hard to follow. I think he talked the most during the luncheon. And okay, the irony of noting that someone goes off track and rambles is not lost on me. Guilty. But it occurred to me I could edit it down and remove some of the rambles and distractions, and that might make it more watchable and more useful. Well, doing that took a lot longer than I thought it would. But I finally got it done. It's down from almost 2 hours to just 30 minutes. You're going to see that the editing is choppy. I didn't try to cover jump cuts or make smooth transitions from one speaker to another. It's just, boom, there's a cut. I don't think you'll care about that. I mean, that's the way the kids do it these days. Have you ever watched TikTok? I don't want to suggest that there's nothing of value in the material that I cut out either. You may enjoy watching the whole thing if you haven't seen it before. So I recommend that you go do that if you want to. So now let's go watch it. With thanks to the How I Do It YouTube channel, this is the 2-1 Group FCC-ARRL Luncheon, condensed.
I'm Tom, K3TKWF.
I put a GMRS repeater up 3.5 years ago, helping to get people into ham. We had some interference. Everyone knows. Called these guys. They told me the procedures. Followed them. That is how this meeting actually started. We solved a major problem that was in this area for 3 or 4 years, 4 or 5 different repeaters.
My name is Bob Familio. My call sign is K3RF, K3 radio frequency, licensed since January of 1967. My day job is practicing law, but the rest of my job is representing ARRL members and hams that aren't members, Eastern Pennsylvania section manager, and I am now have the pleasure of being the director for the Atlantic Division for the American Radio Relay League. I've got this wolf hung here, if you know what that is.
Well, good afternoon. My name is Jeff DiPolo, calls Whiskey November 3 Alpha, the ARRL Eastern Pennsylvania Technical Coordinator. And then also I'm involved with the Area Repeater Coordination Council, ARCC. I've been involved in repeater coordination for, I guess, over 30 years at this point, as one of the founding officers of the organization, and currently serve as the Vice President of Coordination and Database Manager.
My name's Al, and I'm one of the agents down here in the Columbia Field Office. I'm the guy who does like a lot of stuff at nighttime and gets out there and helps with you, works with you guys on a lot of other cases. We're a bunch of hams here. I've been licensed since 79. And coming into the commission from an amateur side, there's a lot of stuff I did not know.
Hi, everybody. My name is David Dombrowski. I've been working for the commission since I got out of Temple University, graduated as an engineer. I did the enforcement work in Harrisburg in Pennsylvania. But when 2016 happened, I lost my job as a district director at that point. I was the manager of the Philadelphia office. I was lucky to get hired as the manager for the region. So I managed 4 offices, Columbia, Maryland, Boston, Chicago, and New York. That's region 1. It's got to get approved by the chairwoman's office, this presentation. So they were going through my presentation notes.
I'm Laura Smith, and I'm the person you all hate. Yeah. I am in charge of amateur enforcement for the agency, but quite often I help Al out with the GMRS cases. I am here simply to answer any questions you might have, or if Dave has any issues that he wants me to address, I can do so. Oh, this is Mr. Hollingsworth.
Thank you. I was told to go last so the room gets cleared out and they don't have to pay overtime.
I just want to talk a little bit about the FCC and give you just our perspective of how to work with you guys, how we take complaints, our priorities. The main priority of the FCC, it's to ensure a competitive framework for our communication sector. We give them a framework of rules and we let the competition handle it. We are divided into bureaus and offices. Wireless Bureau is the one you get your license through. We have our Public Safety and Homeland Security Bureau. An interesting aspect of them is the HFDF Center, High Frequency Direction Finding. They have receivers all over the country and in some of our U.S. territories where they can actually geolocate a source of transmissions below 30 megahertz. And then you have the Enforcement Bureau. We have to be the experts in all these radio services because we're out there investigating not only amateur and land mobile, broadcast, cable, you name it, we've come across it over the years. In 2016, we had a modernization happen. They reduced the size of the field staff and they reduced the number of field offices. Spectrum Enforcement Division, we work hand in hand with. This team is lawyers and engineers who work on the equipment authorization side. Office of Engineering Technology issues the equipment authorizations. Spectrum Enforcement does the enforcement in this area. So if you have a device out there that seems to have a trend of causing a lot of interference, we investigate it and notice that trend, or you could bring it to us. We'll raise that to the level of the Spectrum Enforcement Division. They will contact the manufacturer and work with them. They may do a letter of inquiry, ask some questions about it. They want to ask about the design of the device, and they want to try to get compliance. They want to get this device off the shelves. The enforcement side of it is divided into three regions. Again, I handle Columbia, Boston, New York, and Chicago. My counterpart in the South, it's now called Region 2, that's Diedrich Rubinsky. He covers Atlanta, Dallas, Miami, and New Orleans. And then Lark Hadley, he does Los Angeles, San Francisco, Denver, Portland, and Honolulu. Down in Hiram, Georgia, just outside Atlanta, they do our equipment development where they design our direction finding vehicles. These are covert vehicles. They have all kind of fancy electronics in it. When I got hired into the agency back in the 90s, that equipment would take up the whole front seat, the passenger seat. It's now reduced down to the under the armrest, believe it or not. Everything fits under the armrest. And then we have this incredible team of that's here with me today. After the modernization, reduced staff, we can't resolve every complaint. So we had to prioritize things. Public safety being our number one priority, have to respond within 24 hours of a complaint filed by public safety entities. The next level is enterprise wireless. They are commercial providers like your broadcasters, your cellular companies, microwave companies, land mobile. Those complaints usually have to be worked between 2 and 5 days. Next is unlicensed operation and operation at variance from the license. So those are the complaints we put at our third tier. Under that is pirate radio. Pirate radio is a big project we've been working on. It's take a lot of our resources, legal and engineering resources. The next level complaint is consumer complaints. And these are the ones where you would file. They start to come at the lower priority. These are ones that involve reception of broadcast stations, amateur complaints, interference to home electronics equipment, and jamming, to name a few. When those complaints come in, I don't have a responsibility to work all of them. I just don't have the resources. But when we get them, we need information from you in those complaints. Tell us when the interference is happening, how often. Give us some really good details, the frequencies involved, who you think it might be involved, where you're hearing the interference. Give us some recordings. You can attach those recordings to the complaint. That really helps us show the interest and the impact that complaint is having on the communities. Personal radio services is kind of at the bottom where we have GMRS, citizens band radio, and multi-use radio services. We used to not do these in around 2016 when we had the modernization. We weren't doing any investigations in these areas. But Mike Rose supports it just like I do, just like Laura knows that if you do, and Riley too, we talked about this at the luncheon recently, if you do a couple violations and investigate some of those complaints, it has this effect of a deterrence. We have a portals to file these complaints online. When it comes to amateur complaints, let's talk about that process a little bit. When we receive them, they go right to Laura. All right, Laura gets all of them. Laura tries to handle them. She'll make a decision whether she can handle it herself, maybe a phone call, maybe a warning letter. But if it requires some on-scene investigative work, we have a memorandum of understanding with the ARRL that we use the observers to go out and collect that evidence. And then if they can't get compliance, they will file a report with us. And then it comes to Laura, and then Laura decides whether to funnel to the field office. I don't think there's one case I've never taken from you. I always, if it's coming from Laura and Laura's asking, we're going to do it. When we do sanctions, we have several levels of sanctions we could take. Warning letters is the first one. We don't need a lot of evidence for a warning letter. We don't need to collect any. We could just base it on a complaint and send a warning letter out. So that's a lot of times we use warning letters. The problem is that is we're not getting exposure because they're not released to the public. They're actually sent directly to the operator, and you may not be aware of it. So there's a lot of that going on in the background when we get complaints. But if we do send a field agent out, we need to collect the evidence to support a notice. That could be just a warning letter, like a notice of unlicensed operation or a notice of harmful interference. If the problem continues, then we may issue a notice of apparent liability, which is a fine. Notice of apparent liability says that you willfully and or repeatedly violated the FCC rules. It gives the person who violated the rules an opportunity to respond. They could either pay the fine, ask for a reduction, or they could ask for a payment plan. A lot of times they don't respond. They get them, they just ignore them. Well, that what happens is they now, we issue a forfeiture order says now you must pay it because you didn't respond. Or the facts that you gave us in the case don't support that we should dismiss this, so we're going to go forth with the violation. After the forfeiture order is issued, they do have an opportunity to appeal, maybe go to hearing. If it has a fine attached to it, it can get sent to the Department of Justice for collection. We've issued some significant fines recently. Robocalls, we had a $300 million fine. Pirate radio, we had several fines in the amount of $2 million. And then in terms of the amateur and GMRS, mentioned a couple fines here. Howard Gorski, 2019, $17,000 for intentional interference to amateur radio. Jamie John Leone in Rockford, Illinois. This person was intentionally jamming to interfere with everybody on the CB band, $25,000. Jonathan Guertes, intentional interference, transmitting music in continuous tones and failing to transmit the call sign on GMRS frequency. Philip Bardet proposing a penalty of $24,000. Interfering with amateur net, the Western Amateur Radio Friendship Association. Jason Frawley, intentional interference to U.S. Forestry Services. As the planes were flying over trying to put out a fire, he was communicating with them and causing interference. And they got fined $34,000. So there's a lot of enforcement work, and it takes a lot of effort to do those.
Show of hands, how many of you guys have linked GMRS repeaters?
It's not linked.
That's the question should be asked. You can't link it in the internet. It's like using Zello. Because you can use a control to turn it on and off. But you can't link, or what they say in the rules, you can't convey GMRS traffic. And it says right there in the webpage, you cannot link them or connect them by any type of network. Now, you can control them, turn them on and off. Yeah, that's one of the things. Someone somehow got something from wireless that said you can do this. Well, there's been some bad information being put out there.
What are the ramifications for somebody who's crazy enough to ignore a sanction letter from the FCC?
Are you talking about just a warning letter or a fine? A fine. Okay, so if we find someone and they elect not to pay, what the agency does is they will issue a forfeiture order at that point. Originally, we send out a notice of apparent liability and then a forfeiture order saying we have assessed this fine. If they elect not to pay at that point, then we send it to the Department of Justice. We are a regulatory agency. We are not cops. So we send it to Justice, and then Justice initiates a proceeding. During the course of that proceeding, they will go before a judge. And if the individual shows up, they have the opportunity to present their case, as does the attorney for Justice. And if the judge rules in the favor of the agency, then Justice has the ability to garnish them. If in the course of this proceeding you continue to operate on, you buy new radios, or you continue to violate the rules, the commission can also go to an in rem proceeding, and we can come out with marshals and take the equipment. And at that point, Dave and his team gets to have a party and destroy it with hammers.
On a daily, weekly, monthly, however you formulate your metrics, how many complaints do you get? And The second part is, what's the percentage that end up in an actual fine?
I get between 300 and 400 cases a year. And I happen to actually know that because we were able to run those metrics on our computers. We track everything that comes in via our online system. There is a permanent record. I can't go in and delete your complaint. There's a reason for that. That protects you, that protects me, and that makes sure that the information is contained within the agency for bookkeeping. We have to have a certain amount of records and keep them for 7 years is the time we keep them. A very small percentage end up going to a case. And the reason is I get a lot of complaints in the amateur arena. Pete interrupted Joe and me today. Great. Some guy is, or woman, is coming up on our frequency. When? Where? Who? They provide no details. We get an enormous number of complaints that provide literally no details. Even if I go back to them and ask for additional details, I don't get them on a general rule. They it was a one and done. They got mad, they filed a complaint, so they went to the online system. What are you doing, Riley? I do actually know where you live, and I know your wife. But to finally answer your question, somewhere in the neighborhood of 10 to 15 ultimately go to a case. My job is to stand between you and the field agents. It gives you a point of contact, and it makes sure that once we send it to Dave and his team or any of the other regional directors, it is actually colorable, meaning that there is a real case there. And to get to that case, I actually send it to this guy here and ask them to double check before I send it to Dave's team. So there are several layers in between when you file it and when it goes somewhere.
When you get these flagger guys that are on FRS and you hear about who screwed the night before, who drank the night before, whatever, what advice would you give for somebody like when they monitor and they hear that kind of stuff?
I turn the channel. They can use FRS. When it comes down to scanning, it goes back to, do I want to sit here and listen to this or switch channels on me? PLs, use the PL. That's what they're there for.
All the cases that you work and close out, is that something you can look up on the FCC site?
Our case files, no. So our casework is for internal use only. But all you see is what's left at the end, what gets passed the lawyers and the judges.
Now, if you submitted the complaint, do you get an answer back that it was resolved then?
I always talk back to complainant. You got back to him, this was happening. They can't fix it. Could fix it. Oh, by the way, it is resolved on it. I didn't know that.
Simplex use, the IRLP nodes. Is it legal to operate on a simplex, coordinated simplex frequency?
The commission deliberately and intentionally is not entering this conversation. If you read the rulemakings in which we establish repeaters and coordination, we deliberately and intentionally did not address the issue of what frequencies were or were not to be used. Those are left to the coordinators in the amateur community. If you come to me and you say, I have in this instance, on this date, at this time, at this location, an incident of interference, then we can address it. But we will not do it generically.
So just for clarification with the GMRS, with the talking about linking and whatnot, y'all do not have a problem with microwave or RF. It is strictly internet.
This is the rule that comes down to. It's 95.1749 GMRS network connections. Operation GMRS restations within a telephone connected is prohibited. GMRS repeaters fixed based stations, however, can be connected public switch for sole purpose of remote control. Then it says here, but will not be connected to or other networks to sole purpose of operating. So you can't connect them.
So point-to-point microwave would not work. It's we're doing an RF. I mean, all it is just a higher frequency.
Yeah, it's just other networks.
I have a band plan question. Novice Tech CW area. I know in 10 meters there's a specific area for digital.
Right.
What about 40 meters, 80 meters? Do techs have digital privileges in those areas?
Riley will tell you that that's a pretty big area of volunteer monitoring activity. It is a common misconception that technicians have privileges for data. It's only for CW. By the way, you can use automated CW as long as it's real CW. You, as a technician, little known secret, don't tell anybody I told you, you can get on 40, 80 meters in the technician portion, small portion, and use a keyboard CW. Doesn't say you got to use a key or a straight key, although that's a lot of fun. You can use a keyboard with a program, and you can decode. Some of those decoders are pretty good. And you can talk with people. It has to be genuine A1 or CW, right. Continuous wave, intermittent continuous wave. But you can't use data. You can't use all those cool modes. And that's why you've got to get your general, which I would argue is very easy to do. We are, by the way, the ARRL is petitioning to increase technician rights. That's been pending for some years now. Riley would know. I think it's an automated system now, is it not? You get violators by having a system that's doing sweeping.
Yeah, we have volunteer monitors that run computer programs that match up the license with the frequency and so forth. But in fairness to the people doing it, there's a lot of band plans out there that when you look at them, it's very confusing. And it looks like they can do FT8. And then the question comes up, well, if we can do CW, why couldn't we do FT8? That's easy. And I don't know the answer to that. But and 80% or 90% of our cases, it was absolutely a misunderstanding.
Is there any low-cost, no-cost software to automate some of our DFing instead of going out with a handheld and a Yagi and compass?
That's the best technique in the world right there. Costs nothing. You get $1 billion, buy what you got to get.
Probably the most common that you see out there, they're known as pseudo-Doppler units. They typically have 4, sometimes 5 antennas, mag mounts. These space out on the roof of a vehicle, and you have a control head, and you hook it up to a receiver, and it effectively, it does more or less an electronic scanning, and it'll give you a bearing to the signal source. Some of the better units then integrate with mapping software so that you can plot bearings, and bearings tend to not be consistent because you have multipath reflections, et cetera. So it'll kind of give you a rough bearing, and as you get closer to it, it'll kind of narrow it down better. And if you could triangulate it from multiple directions, that's even better. I think even MFJ makes one. There's another one called from KN2S. Doppler Systems makes a more professional one. But yeah, there's a number of them out there like that. I guess this is for Laura and Dave and maybe Riley. I know that there are a lot of warning letters that are sent that are never put on the website. What's the policy for which ones make it to the website and which ones don't? And in general, wouldn't it be good to publish, the more that are published, the better in terms of deterring others from doing the same kind of things that you're sending warning letters about?
No, we don't post anything that's not a final action by the agency. And a warning letter is actually not a final action. That might be a first action. This was done at the behest of our general counsel's office, who felt that we were releasing information prematurely. And they directed that we no longer publish anything that is not a commission final action. I understand the potential implications of putting that out there. It's certainly, you know, Riley and I talk about this a lot. It acts as a deterrent, sure. And you would see a lot more that you don't know is going on behind the scenes. But we have to take into consideration the fact that these are, for the most part, initial actions, and what may or may not happen after that, we can't do anything until we take a final action. Yeah, 5 or 6 years ago, we Riley and I chatted about it as it was happening, and we used to publish all of them. We would remove the name or the addresses, but with the amateurs, all that stuff's in ULS anyway, because they put it as part of their licenses. By the way, if you don't want people to know your license or your address, put a post office box when you get your first license. Just putting that out there, because I get a lot of people saying, can we have that removed? Sure, but you know, the internet's forever. So it's going to stay out there. About 5 years ago, OGC decided that we couldn't publish them anymore.
The question was whether or not advanced class licensees would be upgraded to extra and just eliminate the advanced class entirely, just grandfather.
That would be something you would have to present to the Wireless Bureau. We're enforcement. Enforcement just enforces the rules as they exist. We take no position with respect to policy. That is a policy question. And certainly you can file a petition with the Wireless Bureau requesting that. And then, you know, we'll take care of it after you have died, because we're the agency and, you know, we have a big backlog.
Al, if you would go through, like, you receive a complaint about interference and you're coming up and investigating it and you find it, could you please go through the steps between, like, you've gathered your information and you hand it off to Laura for prosecution?
I get assigned the case from the director, and it gets through the headquarters, comes down to our region if it's in our region, and then we start scrutinizing it, and then we try to figure out what the loads are. Once you get the case, me and my colleagues will sit down and talk about the case. So now I start looking at what can I do remotely, getting the information, and I have to make the arrangements to get on scene with the vehicles, taking the right technology with me to go find it. So that technology could be anything from me driving a truck up there to gathering information from what happened a couple times here, to going down, I have to go collect with my remote sensors. Knocking on the door is really, really thing that we do. Because the jammer, we want that resolved right now. But all in reality, I don't have to knock on your door. I just collect the information, confirm who you are, I'm the witness too, and say, okay, cool. And just go, hey, this is what the evidence I have. Solid evidence? Oh, it's not? Okay, I'll go back out. But if I go to knock on your door or give you the letter, I'm pretty sure my responsibility has been met because I know for sure it's coming from you. The evidence goes forward. We start talking to the lawyers. We get the paperwork written up, and they go back and forth. Those lawyers got a lot of work going on there, a lot of work. Because the constitutional responsibility is this. Before I accuse you, I'm going to make sure it's you. And then once I hand it off to lawyers, we're done.
Okay, so. Then Laura, what's your process once you receive it?
Well, once the case gets forwarded for legal, and I actually only handle amateur, but you know, there are a lot of other cases that go before other attorneys in the Enforcement Bureau. We review the case file, and then we have to draft an NAL. The NAL will go through an enormous review process. We have a whole agency full of lawyers, and all of them have an opinion. So it goes through that, and once it has been reviewed and re-reviewed, and we've changed happy to glad and glad to feeling good, and ultimately we get an approval, it then goes to, if it's below $25,000, it will go out at a bureau level. If it's above $25,000, it has to go through yet another review process. Our general counsel will review it. It will go to the commissioners. Then if it's below 25, our bureau chief can sign it. If it's above 25, it, he has to have a vote of a majority. There are five of them. They also have their own legal teams, and they also have more edits. And then ultimately, it will go out the door. That's a notice of apparent liability. You will have an opportunity to respond to that. You can either do it in person, in filing. You can pay it. Dave went through the whole litany of what is available to you at that point. At some point, if the agency believes that the notice of apparent liability is legitimate, i.e. that Al and his team have done their job and the case is solid, then we will go to a forfeiture order. That says that the notice of apparent liability is now due and owing to the United States government. You can either pay it at that time or you can appeal it. You can take it to the district courts if you wish. You can file a petition for review and ask that the commission reconsider on its own motion. There are a whole litany of things that are available to you. You can also decide not to pay it, which we talked about earlier. Then we will send that particular one over to justice for enforcement. But at that point, many times the individual will either negotiate a consent decree and bring it down, or they will pay the fine.
I'm going to turn my question around earlier. Let's say it was McDonald's complaining about Amazon's frequency, and I have secure buildings where I don't let the public in or I don't let law enforcement in. What's my time frame to allow you access? Can I put you on a list and get you 24 hours access, or have you got some?
We understand security requirements. You see what we have to do down in D.C. Biggest thing is that we're federal agents, and a lot of people don't understand the dynamics we go on with it. Sometimes we have to wait, and that's just the way
it is. Okay, that's just what I wanted to know.
Yeah, sometimes we wait. But if I knock on someone's door, if I go to you as an amateur or whatever, and I knock on the door, you know, I don't want you to look at my station. Okay. But you want me to look at it now, or you have to clean the house up before I get home?
I mean, it's partly also going to depend on the case, if it's a jammer or a PSIX. But the bottom line is we're looking for compliance. You don't let us in, but the signal goes away, we're okay with that. We're going to come back and check and make sure that permanently goes away.
But no, it really matters about the casework and how serious it is. You know, I'm not going to say, I'm not going to tell the Highway Patrol, the FAA, I'll come back in 3 weeks. No, I'm here now, and I'm not leaving. We had a case of a power company that had a problem with a system management system, and the planes were flying over. Like, well, we just lost our GPS. So we moved out there on a Friday afternoon, and we stayed for a couple hours and said, look, we're not leaving until it gets turned off and plugged, cut out. Well, you don't have a right to transmit this. So they came on over, and they fired it really quick. So who are you? It's what bully button you push. And I'm not leaving until it gets removed because of the safety of life of flight. So there's a part, like my director was saying, there's a whole thing in here, but we take it serious enough out to go, hey, what's next? I'm not leaving.
We have the capability to call local law enforcement in and make that knock, whatever it is, if needed.
If you guys have any quick final comments to go down the list here to give these guys whatever.
I'd only say that for the ARRL, the National Association for Amateur Radio, we are here as a resource. It's a non-government organization. We don't make the rules. We do advocate for rules. Right now, we have a longstanding petition for technician enhancement to give technicians digital rights. You can file your own petitions. Typically, we're a little better at it. And if you're an NHOA, we're working really hard and spending a lot of your favorite dollars trying to get legislation in Washington to give you the same rights for an antenna in an HOA that TV receivers have under the OTARD rules, over-the-air television reception, that you can put an antenna even if the HOA rules don't allow you.
The other thing I wanted to say was that amateur radio is somewhat unique in that the commission gives us a very loose framework as far as the rules that we have to operate within. And they do that because amateur radio is supposed to be self-policing. And these fine people to my right should be, I think, kind of our last line of defense. We should only turn to them when we've exhausted all of the other options and remedies available within our ranks.
I ought to say on behalf of FCC, thank you for the invite. This was incredible. We haven't done this for years, and we look forward to doing it a few more times.
When I finish, you can go home and tell your family you went to church on Thursday. But I just want to say you're sitting on billions and billions of dollars worth of spectrum. And you need to operate as if at the end of the day, it's all about amateur radio. And it may be that we have our spectrum because it's inherently unstable, or nobody's thought of a use for it yet. But I remember being at the FCC when we laughed at people talking about the use of 800 megahertz. And years later, we were helping with multi-million-dollar auctions. So you need to operate as if you want amateur radio to last 100 years. I used to say 1,000, but even a planet won't be here then. I'd be happy with 1,000. But if you hear people that are an embarrassment, cut them loose, go somewhere else. Most of the problems on the amateur bands at HF can be solved just by turning the big knob. And you can go look at an Allied radio catalog from 1960, and you can look at a DX engineering catalog from yesterday. Every radio in there has one big knob. It's an idiot filter. Just turn it. And then you don't hear them anymore. But the rest of the world has a saying about Americans. Americans will lose butt to save face. And I hear it on the frequencies all the time. Just don't go there. Right now, in our society, society's mean, it's rude, it's ungrateful. You see people arguing over a parking spot at Walmart when there's 100 parking spots available, and probably one of them pays $80 a month to go to the Y for exercise. But they want to park in front of the Walmart. It's just the way people are. There are people that I'm sure win the lottery and bitch about how it's paid out. They want it every 2 weeks instead of every month. It's just the way we are. Amateur radio is a pendulum, it's a cross-section of society, and that's been a plus for us. It isn't right now, so just don't be part of it.
All right, hey, real quick, I just want to thank you guys so much. It meant a lot to me, and I know you guys are busier than hell. Thank you so much, and these guys will do whatever they need to do.